wisdom to help us in times of trouble and great distress, Lord God. Your wisdom, Father. You said we can take that, Father God, from the table that you prepared for us, Lord God. You said we can reach in and take it, Lord God. We can take it with our faith, Father God. We can take it, Lord God. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you for that. We bless you for that this day, Lord God. Father God, we pray for this service. We pray, Father God, for Pastor Terrence, Lord God, the overseer of this great word, Father. We thank you for his life. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, that you set a hedge of protection about him. We thank you for Pastor Latrilla. Thank you for her life. Thank you for the work you called them to do here, Father God. We thank you, Father God, as she delivered the word today, Lord God, that she would deliver the word in honesty and in truth, Father God. We thank you, Father God, that she has studied and she has prepared herself, Lord God, that she is a workman that needed not be ashamed, Lord God, that she will rightly divide the word of God this day in the name of Jesus, Father. We thank you for that. We thank you, Lord God, that your words would go forth through the airways and it would land on hearts that are receptive, hearts that are willing to take the word, Lord God, and run with it, Father, in Jesus' name, and use the word and apply it to their lives, Lord, in Jesus' name. And Father God, we thank you for our partners, for everybody that will be on the other side listening. We pray, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord God, that you would bless them. We pray, Lord God, that they have had a blessed Christmas, Lord, that everything that they're needing and wanting, Lord God, you are able to perform, to give, to render to them this day in the name of Jesus. Thank you for our partners, Father. Thank you, Lord, for the connection they have to this ministry. Thank you that you withhold no good thing from them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord God, for the sound tech. Thank you that you'll hover over that area, Lord, in Jesus' name, that you'll hover over that area. Let your spirit, Lord God, be right there as our sound people, Lord God, do what they are called to do today in Jesus' name. Father God, we thank you that they would do it in honesty and in truth, that they would do it in precision, Lord, in Jesus' name, and they would do it by the unction and leading of the Holy Spirit, Lord. We thank you for that this day. Thank you for our sound tech. And we just thank you for your presence, Lord. We thank you for your presence most of all, Lord God. We thank you for your presence in our lives, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that you're God. And we give you first place, Lord Jesus. We thank you for all that you've done, for all that you will do. Lord, we thank you this morning. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We honor your presence, Lord. We magnify you, Lord God. We give you, Father, all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise because you're God. You're God all by yourself, Father, and you need no help from us to be who you are, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you're God. Oh, Lord, you're God. You're God. You're Lord of our lives, and you're Lord of our circumstances and our situation. You're Lord, Father. You're Lord all by yourself, and we thank you this morning, Father. We bless you this morning, Lord. We honor you this morning. We give you, Father God, all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Good morning. Hallelujah. Good morning, Bridge Church of Alabama family and friends.
Hallelujah.
Come on, come on and praise the name of the Lord with us this morning as we go into our time of praise and worship. Hallelujah. Come on, get up out of your bed.
Yes.
Hallelujah. As we magnify the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. Glory. How many of you know that we need to not lean on our own understanding, but put our faith and our trust in God. Amen. Hallelujah.
Write them on,
write them on the tablet of your heart.
Yeah. Write them on,
write them on the tablet of your heart.
I am the vine, you are the branches, he who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. alive, no one gets to the Father except that he come through me. Let not mercy,
let not mercy
and truth,
and truth
forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake.
Let not mercy,
let not mercy
and truth,
and truth
forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake,
forsake.
Write them on,
write them on the tablets of your heart. I am the way.
He's the truth.
The truth and the life. No one gets to the Father.
No one can get to the Father except that go through
Jesus. Except that he comes through me.
Let not mercy.
Let not mercy.
And truth.
And truth. And truth.
Forsake.
Forsake you.
Forsake.
Forsake.
Let not mercy.
Let not mercy. On the
all right, come on now. Hallelujah. How many know that the word of God is a lamp unto our feet? Hallelujah. And a light unto our path.
Write them on the tablet of your heart.
Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Trust in the Lord with all your mind. Trust in the Lord with all your strength.
Lean not to your own understanding.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your might.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your strength. Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Trust in you, oh God.
Trust in the Lord with all your might.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your strength.
Lean not
to your own understanding.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your I will hide your word in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
Hey, trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your might.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your strength.
Lean
not to your own. Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Trust in you, oh God.
Trust in the Lord with all your might.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your strength.
Lean
not to your own understanding.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
Hallelujah, Father, we thank you for your word. Hallelujah, for the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word. The Word was God, and the Word was with God. So, Father, we will put our hope on nothing less than your word, oh God.
Lean not to your own understanding.
Joshua 1 and 8 tells us to meditate day and night in the word of God, and let not the word of God depart out of our mouths. So Father, we thank you for your word, oh God, and we won't lean on our own understanding. Lean not.
Lean
under our feet. And we know that the Bible also tells us that not one jot or tittle will pass away, but it will shut and shall come to pass.
Lean not to your own understanding. I will hide your word in my heart.
Worship, Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. I'm free to dance, yeah.
Free to dance,
said I'm free to lift my hands.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
Said I'm free to move around.
I'm free to dance.
Yes, I'm free to lift my hands.
Yes,
Lord. Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
'Cause I'm free.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
Oh Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
I'm free.
I'm a free worshiper.
Yes, I'm free.
I'm a free worshiper.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
I'm free to dance, yeah. Lord, I'm free to lift my hands. Yes, Lord.
Lord,
I'm
Lord,
free.
I'm
said I'm free to move around, yeah.
I'm free to dance.
Oh, I'm free to lift my hands. Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
'Cause I'm free.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
Yes, Lord. Lord, I'm free.
I'm a free worshiper.
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 Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
And I thank God I'm free.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
And I'll never be bound again. Yes, I thank God I'm free. And I'll never be bound again. I thank God I'm free.
I thank God I'm free.
And I'll never, never, no,
and
never,
be bound again.
Oh, I thank God I'm free. Yeah.
I thank God I'm free.
And I'll never, never,
and
no,
I'll
never,
never be bound again.
I thank God I'm free. I'll never, never,
and
no,
I'll never be bound again.
Oh, I thank God I'm free.
I thank God I'm free.
And I'll never, never,
and
no,
I'll never,
never
be bound
a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper.
Yes, I am.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
I'm a free worshiper.
Oh, Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm free.
Lord, I'm
Lord, free. I'm free.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
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 Oh, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
When the sun sets free.
Lord, I'm free.
It's truly free indeed.
Lord, I'm free.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I'm free.
Hey. Oh, oh,
oh.
Oh, oh.
Oh, oh.
Sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Amen. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Amen. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Amen. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Amen. So I thank God I'm free.
Yeah.
And I'll never be bound again.
Yes, Lord. Oh, oh, hallelujah. You made us free, oh God. We're free to worship you, Lord. We're free to worship. We're free to praise your name, oh God. So we worship you today, oh God. We worship you, oh God. Here we are, Father. We've come to worship you in spirit and in truth, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Here we are to worship you, oh God.
Stepped out into darkness, open my eyes, let me
spent with Presence, oh God. We honor you, Father. We thank you, Lord. We bless you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. All honor belongs to you, oh God. We bless you. We honor you, oh King of Kings. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good morning, Bridge Church of Alabama family and friends. Thank you so much for being here today. Hallelujah. I know you all expected a transition slide, but hey, God is doing a new thing today. Amen. Amen. Bless the name of the Lord.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, Bridge Church of Alabama family. Woo. God says, what you gonna do? Amen. What you gonna do? Are you gonna trust me? or are you going to trust yourself? Are you going to trust me or trust yourself? Come on now. I don't know about y'all, but I know trusting myself hadn't got me very far. But when I put my trust in God, I got to go like the old saints. But when I put my trust in God, hey, come on now. My life was changed for the better. Amen. 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 And now I'm free. Woo! Now I'm free. I'm free to do what he has called me to do and be who he has called me to be. You know, when people say, you know what, sometimes don't take all that. If you know my story, you know it take that and then some. Come on now. You know, my old pastor said at my brother's memorial, she said, if everybody would take their problems and throw them out in the street, we would all go out and pick up our own. Because sometimes we don't talk about what's going on. So we don't really know what's going on in people's lives. And you think that, you know, we look from the outside and say people are being blessed. Oh, this one's being blessed and that one's being blessed. But you don't know where they've been to be blessed like they are. Sometimes we want the blessings, but we don't want to go through the work and the struggle that it took to get those blessings. Amen? So be careful, be careful, be careful what you ask for. Because you just might get it. Amen? But you better be prepared when you do. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, Bridge Church of Alabama family. As always, my name is Kenya Pinnegar, and I'm here before you to do the welcome. So if there's any first-time guests, I think we're all family in the building, but if there's any first-time guests tuning into our live stream for the first time, please drop a heart, drop a wave out there. Just let us know you're out there. We want to share a little love with you and let you know that you're welcome. But understand, as I always say, the first time you're a guest, the second time you're family. But as Pastor says, after you're the first time you're family, amen. Within a few seconds, you're family, amen. But we just want to show you a little love, and on behalf of our pastor, Pastor Terrence Nolan, and our other pastor, Latrilla Nolan, who we get the pleasure of hearing speaking today, amen, we want to just welcome you, welcome you, welcome you to the Bridge Church of Alabama family. Amen. Come on, Bridge Church, let's show them a little love. Woo, 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 woo! Thank you for coming. We know that God has sent you here for a purpose, and we know that you'll get what you came for. Amen? Amen. Amen. And just in lieu of a few announcements, January 3rd will be our corporate time of fasting and prayer, which is our normal first of the month prayer. So just put that, mark that on your calendars. It's January 3rd will be our corporate time of fasting and prayer. And if you would please share what you've been fasting from so that we can pray for you, please do if you would like to. There's no pressure to do so, but if you would like to share what you are fasting for, just so that you can have a few saints in agreement with you, amen. Because they say one will put 1,000, two will put 10,000 to flight. So we want to get these angels busy. Amen? Amen. Also, if you would keep our first lady, but I'm going to continue to correct myself. Keep our Pastor Latrilla in your prayers. Amen. She'll be traveling, doing a return trip to Kenya this year. So everyone, please keep her in your prayers for safe travels to and from, as well as keeping her protected while she's over there doing the work of the Lord. Amen. Amen. And also, our corporate fast and prayer, which is our annual fast and prayer, will be start February 1st of 2022. So prepare now. And again, when we're talking fasting, as I always say, fasting is not always food. I know that's what our mind normally goes to. But fast from anything that is distracting you from God. So that means give up some time to spend with the Lord. We wonder sometimes how come, you know, things aren't going the way that we need them to go in our lives. It's because a lot of times we're not giving God his time. Amen. And God says, just give me some time. That's all I'm asking for. It's just a little time. Give up some of those distractions. You know, we always talk about how busy we are, but sometimes I think we make ourselves busy so we don't have to spend that time, because sometimes we don't want to hear what the Lord has to say. Amen. Amen. Because sometimes he's telling you to give up some things that we don't want to give up, but we got to give them up if we want to go forward. Amen. Amen. Also, I want to announce our New Year's Eve service. Woo, 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 woo. We always have a blessing when we come together in fellowship. So this will be a time of praise, prayer, and power. Amen. It will be starting at 10:30 on Friday night and ending at midnight. And we will be live streaming. So anyone who wants to share a testimony or who watches on the live stream, you can do it virtually, or if you would like to through the Facebook, or if you would like to email us at bridgechurchofal.com, or just simply give us a phone call, and we can share that testimony for you if you're not able to be here in the building. Amen? Amen. So get those testimonies ready. I think that Pastor and First Lady, or pastors, our pastors, have a wonderful time in store for us that night. Amen? Amen. And come with an expecting heart, because I believe that 2022 is going to be a brand new year for a lot of us. Amen. Amen. Also, just a few reminders. Don't forget to join us every Wednesday night for Bible study at 6:30 p.m. Here on Facebook Live, or as well as in the building. You can attend either way. Also, our Wednesday morning virtual prayer is at 11 a.m. And then our live in-person corporate prayer is every first and third Saturday at 11 a.m. here in the building only. And all the times that I'm giving, as I always say, are Central Standard Times for anybody that's tuning in new. They are Central Standard Times, so adjust accordingly. And any information that you, anything that I've announced and you would like more information about, just go to our website at bridgechurchofal.com and click on our events calendar, and you can click on the event that you would like to get the information about. Amen. Amen. We will now have our offertory message. Woo, 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 woo.
God, amen. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Bridge Church family and friends. You are that are out there in virtual land and that are here in the house this morning. We bless the Lord for you. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Pastor T, the senior pastor here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, and I'm here with the Bridgeites. Amen. The foundation of this thing, man. The Bridgeites, the ones that hold up my arms and keep us fighting a good fight of faith. And so we're here today, and we thank God for all of you that are joining us. You heard the announcements, and so, you know, make sure you keep the announcements and put them on your calendar and things like that. And yes, as Kenya said, we will be shooting our live stream for New Year's Eve live. We'll be doing that live. And I want you all to be a partaker again of the New Year's Eve. If you plan on staying home, I mean, how convenient would this be? You'd be able to tune in with a live stream and still be able to make comments, praise the Lord with us, send a testimony to us, and we'll read your testimony live. I've even, you know, said that maybe it might be a possibility for you to call me while I'm up here, and you can I put the mic to the phone, and you can tell your testimony. All right, but we're going to have to keep everybody probably to about a minute, though, you know, because, you know, some testimony. So you have to abbreviate your testimony. But we want to hear what God did, how he did it. So here it is. We want to hear where it started, how God intervened, how he worked it out, and then the testimony of the end result. And we know what the end going to be. We always know the end result. But we like to hear it because we want to hear what God has done, man, in your life. And so join us. It's going to be a time of, what I said, a time of praise, prayer, and power. Praise because we're going to just praise the Lord for where he's brought us from. Praise God because this is where he has us. And we just happy that we're, you know, some of us are like, you know, man, why are we in this season? You know, we need to thank God that he has chosen us for such a time as this. Because that means he has use of us, that there's something valuable in us, because if we had no value, we wouldn't be here. And so he finds us valuable, and so we praise God for being alive in such a time as this. So we're going to praise him for that, and then we're going to praise him for what he has in store for us, what's coming the next year. And so that's the praise part, and then the prayer, we're going to continue to pray, until you turn red in the face, man, we're going to pray because he's deserving of the prayer. You know, and prayer is our communication to him. And we don't want to move forward into the new year without communicating with him. We want to open up the, as they say, open up the doors of heaven, open up the windows of heaven. And instead of him pouring out into us, man, we want to pour into heaven. That's what we're going to do. So we're going to pray that night. We're just going to pray and just get his attention and let him know that we are serious about what he's serious about. And then we're going to, and when we praise, and then when we pray, guess what? The power is going to fall. That's where the power comes in. And then we're going to ask God for the power that he would endow us with power from on high as we go into the new year. So y'all got that? Amen. Praise, prayer, and power, man. We're going to get power. We're going to have our power renewed going to the new year. We don't know what is in store, but we know that when we go in with God, man, can't nobody say it. It doesn't matter how many people are against you, but if God be for you, who can be against you? If God is for you, who can be against you? It doesn't matter who's against you. As long as God is with you, man. And so we're going to, and that's the power we're going to be praising and praying God for on this New Year's Eve. No, we don't have no entertainment. I mean, the entertainment is going to be you. The entertainment is going to be us praising the Lord. That's going to be entertainment. And so if you want to entertain yourselves, come on in and entertain yourselves. But we're going to entertain God today. Today too. We're going to entertain God. We want to get his attention. We want him to have the very best. Amen. Amen. And then, of course, I'm just going to continue to support, you know, what we have already said in terms of the First Lady traveling to Kenya. Just woke up this morning, man, and just realized, I'm like, man, next week this time, you know, as I was preparing and doing my personal hygiene, and I'm looking in the mirror, I'm like, next week this time, and I look over to the left, and you know, we got separate sinks in the restroom and in the bathroom, and I'm thinking next week this time, my sugar plum won't be with me. Is that what John called Sister EJ, his sugar plum? Oh, man, I'm like, my baby won't be here next week this time, man. I'm like, Lord, I need to get my head together now and start working on this, you know. And so we're praising and praying that God will just, you know, take them over there. It's not just her going. Of course, many of the ladies are going. And we're going to be in prayer, praying for their, you know, just safe travel there, asking for favor. Everything go well. You know, nothing missing, nothing broken, nothing gets in the way of God's purpose in their lives. And we're going to continue to pray that. And so, you know, I'm here to encourage you for your giving today. So let me encourage you for your giving, man. I'm used to just get ready to give the word, but I'm not giving the word today. My wife, my lovely wife, the First Lady, is going to be giving the word today. And so I'm here to encourage you your giving. And so with that, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9 in the New Living Translation. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 in the New Living Translation. And I want to begin with verse 9. No. Verse 6. Let's begin with verse 6 in the New Living Translation. And we're going to read 6 all the way down because all of it is important. Remember this. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop. But the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. It sounds like that other scripture, whatsoever a man soweth, that's what he's going to reap. So, but God is saying that when you plant a seed, you know that the seed itself has a way of multiplication. It multiplies what you're putting in. And God's kingdom is just like that. It says, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. So you must each decide in your heart how much you want in return. Because based on what you decide in your heart, what you want to give determines on what you have decided in your heart, what you want in return. And so you have to decide, what is my return? What am I looking for? If you ain't looking for much, then don't plant much. If you're not looking for anything, don't plant nothing at all. Because nothing's going to come back to you if you don't plant anything. And so the Bible is simply, it's so simplistic in your in what you give. Simply saying that if you don't give anything, guess what? Don't expect anything. But if you plan it on getting much, then plant, he said, plant much. And then it goes on to say this. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. Wow, that means that now when you give because you've been giving, because you're giving reluctantly, it seems like it has the same recourse as not giving at all. It has the same recourse, meaning that you kind of like curse your own seed. You're cursing what you're planting. It's almost like you're planting a good seed, but then you come and you put kerosene on top of it instead of water. Because if you give reluctantly, you're giving it without the heart, without the pureness, without what do you do when you plant something and you cultivate it? Without cultivating it properly, it's not going to have an opportunity to grow. So reluctance in your heart does the same thing as a plant you planting in good soil. It doesn't matter how good the soil is. It doesn't matter how powerful the seed is. If you give reluctantly, it's like pouring kerosene on the seed, and you kill the possibility of it growing up. Because when you pour reluctancy on it, when you apply reluctancy, it's like we're applying something that's unhealthy to it. And when you apply something that's unhealthy to it, it causes it not to grow, not to fulfill its full potential. And so when we give, the Bible says this. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. Pressure. Meaning don't, regardless of what someone else is telling you. And as a matter of fact, let's use this as an example. I'm not pressuring anybody to give today. I'm not pressuring you. By no means am I pressuring you. All I'm doing today is reading the word. And I'm breaking it down, precept upon precept, so you have a better understanding in your giving. So if you decide to give, I want to make sure you understand. If you give much, guess what? The Bible says. The Lord has promised that if you give much, you're going to get much in return. It's a law. It's a law that he already created. I'm just explaining to you the law. I'm not pressuring you. I don't want you to give reluctantly. I don't want you to give under pressure. I want you to have a better understanding of giving. Because it goes on and it says in verse 8, and God will generously, hold on, I'm sorry, let me back up. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. For God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Man, if he loves what I do cheerfully, if I give it cheerfully, he loves it. That means I have favor. Man, there's no greater favor than to have the favor of God upon your life. So he loves a cheerful giver. And God will generously provide all your need. Come on now, God will. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scripture says, he said, now he reminds us of his word. They share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. Who's going to remember them? God's going to remember them. He's going to remember them because he loves a cheerful giver. For verse 10, for God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide an increase. Ooh, somebody say increase. Increase, not decrease, but increase. Come on now, this is God's way of doing things. He will provide increase. He will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. Your resources, that means everything that you're already working with, he's going to bless it. Your resources, whatever you got. If it's a car, he's going to bless the car. If it's just $5, he's going to bless it. $5, he's going to multiply the $5. He's going to bless it. Whatever the resources is. Someone is letting you use the building for something, he's going to bless the favor. You're going to have favor. You name it. God's got it. Verse 11. Yes, you will be enriched in every way so that you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. So two good things will result from this ministry of giving. Giving is a ministry. Yeah, I know that. You thought you had to be a minister and had to have a tunic on and all that stuff and have a robe and stuff to be a minister. Giving in itself is a ministry. It says that two good things will result from this ministry of giving. The needs of the believers in Jerusalem will be met. The needs of Jerusalem. And see, the Bible is talking about Jerusalem here, but when we give, because the giving has always been a principle for the church and something that was supposed to continue to be carried on. So now you're not just giving to Jerusalem, but you're giving to the local community. You're also giving, and as you give to the local community, it goes out further out, because each person that receives the giving, they begin to, their lives are changed. And they begin to give God the glory. The Bible says this, that when people see your good works, they will give God the glory. They will worship God because you're able now to do good works. And so they're going to glorify God. And it says, we'll be met, and they will joyfully express their thanks to God. See, there you go. They're going to thank God for it. Verse 13, as a result of your ministry, they will give glory to God. For your generosity to them and to all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. Obedient. That means that if God put up on your heart to give something, don't be reluctant. Just give it. Just allow it. Release it. Don't be reluctant. Just give it. Because there's a blessing in obedience. There's a blessing in obedience. To all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. Verse 14, and they will pray for you with deep affection because of the overflowing grace God has given to you. Thank God for this gift, too wonderful for words. Thank God for this gift, too wonderful for words. The gift of giving. It's too wonderful for words. You can't even, because when you think about just yesterday, we celebrated the Christ's birthday, right? In the Bible, in John 3:16, said God so loved the world that he gave. It's such a ministry. The ministry of giving is so big that you can't even put it into words, because some people can't even understand how God was able to give his son, and how one son, one person was able to die for the sins of the world. And yet our giving is still an example of that greatness, of that ministry that is just too big. We can't even express it in words, but you can express it in deed. Amen. They said love is an action word. So if you love God, you just do what he tells you to do. That's obedience. Amen. Amen. Let me pray over your giving. Father, we thank you for those that are going to give today. We thank you that they will hear your voice and the voice of a stranger they shall not follow. We thank you today, Father, that as they give, God, that you will hold forth your word as you have promised, that as they give generously, Father, you will bless them, God, generously. You will multiply their giving. Allow them, Father God, to receive an abundance. God, you said you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that they will not have room enough to receive. Bless them, God, because their hearts now, Father, have been toiled, and their hearts have been broken up the ground, the ground of their heart. You've broken it up, God, and you made that soil good, God, forgiving. And we thank you for it now today. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Prepare your giving. You have many ways to give here online. If you desire to give online, amen, here are the instructions here. You may text your donation amount to 84321. Again, text your donation amount to 84321. Or you can visit us online at bridgechurchofal.com. That's bridgechurchofal.com. And go to our donate page. We're looking forward to you. Amen. Hearing the voice of the Lord. Amen. And just doing exactly what God has given you to do. And we thank you. We thank you for your giving. We are so appreciative of it. We would not be here without your giving. We know that God uses those who he desires to use. And we've just been a blessed ministry because we are serving a blessed people who believe in this vision here in Opelika. So God bless you. We thank you. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. How is everyone doing today? Bless the name of the Lord. All right. All right. Well, thank you all for joining in with us this morning. We're so glad you're here. Those of you who are in the house, amen. And those who are viewing online, we're so glad you could join us today. God is so good, and I pray that everyone had a blessed, prosperous, and wonderful Christmas, remembering the reason why we are celebrating, amen, and the reason why we are even yet here today. Praise his holy name. It's just been a blessing. Pastor and I actually got an opportunity just to rest and to really just relax and enjoy yesterday, actually the weekend. I think he was off Friday, so we just didn't do anything Friday, didn't do much Saturday, and just kind of just laid back. It was just really nice. And I just want to just thank everyone who tunes in, those of us who are in the house who are kind of know the ins and outs of what's going on here, and to our extended family watching. I want everyone to know that I am excited to officially announce that I have completed all of my online classes and courses to receive my associate degree. So, yes. And I'm just so grateful to God. I know that Miss Mary is one that has definitely been in my corner from day one. When I kind of announced it or acknowledged it as one of my heart's desires. But I have definitely felt the prayers and the support of everyone that is a part of this ministry. And I tell you what, my husband and I, we both earned this degree. And you all as well. But I tell you, it is, and one of the things that I know, and initially, you know how the enemy comes in, right? Now, this is actually just a sidebar. I hadn't even begun my message yet. But anytime we do anything of significance, and it's not necessarily that we receive the glory in it, but God receives the glory, right? And so anytime we do anything of significance, the enemy wants to make us feel like it means absolutely nothing. So just from my own personal standpoint, I know once I even initially started out to get this associate's degree, you know, the enemy was like, an associate's degree? Who gets an associate's degree? What is that? You know, that is, I mean, the less people normally get is going to get a bachelor's. Why are you going to get an associate's? But that's the thing about it. Each one of us, right, we have our own chart, our course to chart. And for me in my life, that is what was charted for me. And me being who I am a person of, I'll confess it, instant gratification. And there is no way I was going to start out trying to get a bachelor's 4 years. I know I would have been fainting, boy. Y'all would have been picking me up so many times. Oh, gone on back. Oh, no. You can do all things. Exactly. But I know for myself that 4 years, that's a long time for me. And so I had to make it, how they say, make smart goals. So I had to make it a smart goal for myself. I had to set it where I could see some type of acknowledgement, progress, you know, earlier than 4 years. So now if I choose to, you know, decide to go back, then that's another story. Because it's, you know, nothing is impossible with God. So now that I've charted this course, now I can reevaluate. So, okay, if I decide to go after the bachelor's now, then guess what? That's only 2 more years, right? So it's all about perspective. And sometimes we have to realize where we are in life, and we cannot look at what somebody else is doing or compare ourselves or even allow the enemy to have you believe that however it is that you choose to progress yourself or to just what's the word I want to use? Improve yourself, you know, for God and his use, that don't allow the enemy to negate whatever it is that God is telling you to do. Amen. Amen. So again, thank you, everybody. The actual commencement ceremony will be in May. And initially, I was like, same thing. I ain't walking for no association. But all this hard work I don't put in, I'm walking. I am walking. So to God be all the glory. I'm just so, and even doing the onset on it, of it, you know, I think I started this in, I think 2018 is when I actually started pursuing it. But life happened. You know, life happened, so of course that means that it's been 3 years for me to actually obtain the degree. But, you know, pastor's illness, just so many different things that came about with life. And it was a learning process in that, because even initially there was a time, and again, I hope this is helping somebody, because God is having me share this, but there was a point even when my life was not conducive to continuing, and I had to basically hit the pause button on it, right? But because I said what I was going to do, because I set the goal and said I was going to finish by this time, so then what I had begun to do was put unnecessary burden on myself. Because this is my life, right? I can set my goals how I want to go about accomplishing the different things that God has me to do. And so there is nothing wrong with readjusting your plan. There is nothing wrong with readjusting your vision so that you can go through it and really feel the experience, so that you cannot be stressed out, so you cannot be worried about, you know, failing in some other area in your life that requires your attention. But just know that because you have to make an adjustment, that doesn't mean that it's still not going to come to pass. Okay. So again, just really, when any time that you set out to do anything, just really hear God. And if he calls you to make adjustments, make those adjustments. That doesn't say anything, make it any less of significant or make it any less important, and it does not say make it any less significant in your life. So it may have been a 2-year degree, I finished it in 3 years, but guess what? I still finish. Amen. I still finish. So that's for somebody out there, prayerfully, that's for somebody. But just be encouraged. But today, I'm gonna just be talking about grace. I'm gonna talk about grace today. And so we're going to start out in, and I'm going to ask you to bear with me just starting out. I'm one of those that like to give context of scripture, so sometimes I may read a whole lot of scripture before and after that one scripture that I want to really focus on, but I want to give context to what it is that I'm trying to relay. And so just bear with me, but let's go in prayer before I begin the message. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we just bless you today. I give you all the glory, honor, and praise for who you are in my life. I thank you that as you have given me this opportunity to come before your people and impart your word, I pray that, Lord, I would be able to divide it, that I'd be able to minister it, precept upon precept, that I may only say what it is that you will have me to say, and that I will stay true to your word, that I will minister it, Father. It will not be compromised. It will not be adulterated. It will not, Father, be altered in any way. I just thank you that all who are here, who are listening, who are receiving this word, I thank you that it will be a word that will cause spiritual understanding. I pray that it will bring enlightenment, and I pray that it will cause all of us to go to higher heights and another level in you. So I thank you now. I give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to look at, I want to start. We're going to go to Matthew chapter 20. And we're going to begin at verse 1. I'm going to read through 16. And I want to read it in the NLT version, please. Verse 1, we're going to chapter 20 in Matthew. We're going to look at verses 1 through 16. Okay, and these verses of scripture is basically in my Bible here, it said that it is a parable of the vineyard workers, okay? So we're going to be talking about those workers who are working in a vineyard. For the kingdom of heaven is like the landowner who went out early one morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay the normal daily wage and sent them out to work. Okay, I'm going to read from my paper. At 9 o'clock in the morning, he was passing through the marketplace and saw some people standing around doing nothing. So he hired them, telling them he would pay them whatever was right at the end of the day. Verse 5. So they went to work in the vineyard. At noon and again at 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. At 5 o'clock that afternoon, he was in town again and saw some more people standing around. He asked them, "Why haven't you been working today?" They replied, "Because no one hired us." The landowner told them, "Then go out and join the others in my vineyard." That evening, verse 8, he told the foreman to call the workers in and pay them, beginning with the last workers first. Okay? Beginning with the last workers first. Verse 9, when those hired at 5 o'clock were paid, each received a full day's wage. When those hired first came to get their pay, they assumed they would receive more. But they too were paid a day's wage. When they received their pay, they protested to the owner, "Those people worked only 1 hour, and yet you've paid them just as much as you paid us who worked all the day in the scorching heat." Verse 13. He answered one of them, "Friend, I haven't been unfair. Did you agree to work all day for the usual wage? Take your money and go. I wanted to pay this last worker the same as you. Is it against the law for me to do what I want with my money? Should you be jealous because I am kind to others? So those who are last now will be first then, and those who are first will be last." So now, let's break this down. So when we look at this, a typical workday here, all right, it began at 6 a.m., and then it would end at 6 p.m. Sunrise was 6 a.m. and sunset would be 6 p.m. So the average working day was 10 plus hours, okay? So the landowner began looking for workers at 6 a.m. And he actually hired on some that began at 6 a.m. Mm-hmm. And he went throughout the whole course of the day hiring more workers. At 5 o'clock, he hired the last set of workers. How many of us would have been like those in verse number 11. When they received their pay, come on, let's be honest now. When they received their pay, they protested to the owner. Those people worked only 1 hour. This is verse 12. And yet you paid them just as much as you paid us who worked all day in the scorching heat. How many of that would be us? Come on now. But check this out. How many of us have experienced the verse where they came first, verse number 8. That evening, he told the foreman to call the workers in and pay them, beginning with the last workers first. So guess what? You have favor. God extended grace and favor to you, right? But what did you go when that happened? Woo! I got paid the same pay. Oh, glory to God. Woo! Woo, the favor. But yet, when you are the one that it appears as though, right, God has not been gracious to you, then you want to protest. But God gave you exactly what he said he was going to do, right? So why is it that we as saints, why do we as Christians, why when things like this happen and the shoe is on the other foot, we are protesting? Why can we not rejoice with others when it happens to them? Right. Why is it that we act that way? Why is that? We think we're missing out on something, but guess what? That may not have been your day to get grace or for God to be generous to you, but guess what? He is the same God. And so next time you may be the one on the generous end, only working an hour, but getting a full day's pay. Amen. Come on now. And I just believe that in the body of Christ, that is something that we, going in deeper into the message. One of the things that we do as human, right, in the flesh, we often look at people outwardly and we determine what they should and should not get. So, okay, all right, well, okay, well, oh, she's so nice. She's always doing this and that. Oh, God should bless her. You know, God should reward her for everything that she does. Yes. But because somebody may be late or because, you know, somebody may always seem like they slacking or they slowful about something, why is God blessing them? Mm-hmm. But we don't know their circumstances. Right. We don't know how God is working. That could be something going on at home. They could have one car and they got three people working. But again, we always look at the outward appearance. We always want to see what's on the outside. Okay, so now when God said this in verse 16, okay, Matthew 20, verse 16, so those who are last now will be first then, and those who are first will be last. So let's go to, we're going to go to a chapter before that. Y'all bear with me again. We're going to go to Matthew chapter 19, because this is when this parable, what we just read, was actually an answer to something that had actually began in chapter 19. So let's go to Matthew chapter 19. We're going to read verses 16 through 30. And this is when Jesus, when the rich young ruler comes to Jesus and inquires of him. We're going to look at it in the, we'll look at this one in the New King James Version, please. Okay. And it reads, verse 16, now behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which ones? Jesus said, you shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 20, the young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Verse 22. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful. And for he had great possessions with God, Then Jesus said to his disciples, assuredly, I say to you that this is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again, I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. When his disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, who then can be saved? Okay, let's pause right there. So right there, the disciples, in their mind, okay, because these people are rich, they automatically assume that these people are definitely going to heaven based off appearance. And so then it's almost like they got nervous and saying, who then can be saved if these people with all this money and great clout and prosperity, if they can't go in, who's going to be able to go in? Let's keep reading. But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men, this is impossible. With God, all things are possible. Then Peter answered and said to him, see, we have left all and followed you. Therefore, what shall we have? So Jesus said to them, assuredly, I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and inherit eternal life. Verse 30. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. So now let's look at this, because they are similar, but they're not the same. So now in verse 16, it says, okay, check the wording. So those who are last now will be first then, and those who are first will be last. But when we just read in 30, it says, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. So now in verse 16, the reward here is basically it's justice, or it's righteousness. It's the generosity of God. That is what the reward is. But here in verse number 30, in verse 19, the reward is judgment, because the rich young ruler, he didn't want to give away the money. And so because of his love of the money, then he will be judged. Right? And so because the disciples, even in how they looked at him outwardly, but many who are first, they looked at them as being first because they had all this money and clout. So the first will be last and the last first. But in chapter 20, it's saying, but those who are last, that means the ones that came at the last hour, those will be first. And those who are first will be last, meaning that God will extend his grace. So just to say to whoever you are, wherever you are in life, right, whether you feel like, and that's the other thing that, let me just go with my notes. So when we think about how we judge people, right, I have in my notes here, that we judge and reward people based off of physical works, right, what they do, by what we see their visible morality, okay, by how old they are, you know, the older somebody's been, or, you know, we give them, we just chalk wisdom up to them and give it to their account, by years as a Christian, right, because they've been serving the Lord so long. And I want to, even with that, God has shown me in this season that even in, and I'm not discounting the pillars of faith who have gone before us and really paved the way for faith. But nowadays, if you look at how ministry is now going forth and we're doing this e-church, there are a lot of small ministries that are preaching and teaching the word of God that are getting just as much, I don't want to say recognition, they are doing just as much in the word of God and in the kingdom than someone who has been around for 50 years, is my point. So even in that, God is really, it's like, you know, as he said in his word, that he'll pour out his spirit on all flesh. So if anyone is willing to minister and give the word of God, guess what? God is no respecter of person. Just because this minister over here has been doing it 50 years doesn't mean that the same person over here with a pure heart that's been doing it for 5 years, they're going to receive the same reward. That's come right. on now. Right. And they will produce the same fruit. Mm-hmm. So even in that, because I find myself, just transparent moment, that even with us being a small ministry, because I have to do, you know, I do the Facebook and most of the media on the line things. You know, they all have all the insights and how many people logging in. They, you know, some people view 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 30 seconds. Well, there was a time where I was really getting caught up in that, right? And I was saying, God, you just ain't using us. The numbers ain't, you know, we don't never get above 30 people. But God showed me this scripture right here and the fact that it doesn't matter. And we will reach who God is calling us to reach. And that is the most important thing, right? Okay, but so getting back to the lesson is the fact that because we always look outwardly and we judge people on merit. But not only do we judge people on merit, but we also, when it comes to us, we see ourselves the same way. Because when it's time for God to bless us or to extend his grace, we then say to ourselves, well, I haven't been doing this or I haven't been doing that. You know, well, man, I haven't really been doing it that long. God, he ain't gonna bless me. But it's all about our expectations. God is a merciful and a gracious God, and he will bless you in spite of who you are. He knows who you are. He knows everything about you. He created you, right? And so he goes beyond all of that. But so the other thing that I want to point out is the fact that because we like to do this, because we always, I don't want to say always, but because we sometimes want to put a value on what other people's life is like or what they, then we decide whether or not we're going to extend the grace. And I have some acronyms this morning because I want us to, because my message is grace. What is your position? So on the one hand, when we looked at and we read, the first set of scriptures in Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16, was it? Yes. So in that regard, right? So in that regard, those people were, and this is my acronym here. It's going to be GRACE. And so these are the things that we should not be. We should not be grudge-hearted. We should not reject what God has said in his word about us being generous. And we're going to go over some scriptures, but I just want to give you this. We should not be angry. We should not be angry when God blesses somebody else. We should not compare ourselves with what we have done versus what somebody else has done, like they did in the scriptures. Well, they, how you gonna pay them the same thing when this, you can't compare yourself to somebody else, regardless of what it looks like. And then we should not be envious and jealous of when God blesses somebody else, okay? And what we should be, and again, I'm gonna go back and break all this down, is instead of being that type of being in that position of grace, being grudge-hearted, rejecting what God has said in his word about being generous, being angry when we see somebody else being blessed, comparing ourselves to other people, and then being envious and jealous of what God is doing for somebody else's life, we should be generous and we should be giving. We should want God to be to extend that grace, because guess what? We're going to want that same grace back, right? We should be righteous. We are the righteousness of God, and he has called us to be righteous. We should be accepting. We should be accepting of people for who God created them to be, right? Because we have been accepted and we have been adopted and to we have been adopted as heirs and joint heirs with Christ. We should be compassionate. We should extend compassion, be tenderhearted when it comes to others, be extend kindness instead of always judging someone by what we see. And we should be edifying and we should be extravagant in forgiveness. We should be ready to extend forgiveness and be generous with our grace towards other people. So let's go and we're gonna discuss the first one. So grudge-hearted. Grudge means having a feeling or a sense of deep resentment or ill will towards someone. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 22 and 16.
What version?
I think I did these in the New Living Translation. I think so. Chapter 22, verse 16. Oh, no, this is the New King James Version. NKJV. Mm-hmm. And it reads, He who oppresses the poor to increase his riches, and he who gives to the rich will surely come to poverty. Okay? Meaning that we don't want to be able to give to someone who is less fortunate, which is basically what God was doing in chapter 20. He was basically wanting to, and let me go back and say that in chapter 19, the disciples were asking, their question was, when Peter asked the question, who then can be saved? And so basically what God was saying or what Jesus was saying is that basically those who will be saved it's basically what he's saying was that those who are viewed as less important or less worthy of God's glory are the ones who can and will be saved. Okay. I want to make that point. So let's not be grudge-hearted. Let's extend whenever we can and want to see other people blessed. So then we talked about we should not be, we should not reject God's word. Let's go and look at verse, I'm sorry, Romans, I was reading my notes. Romans chapter 2, verses, we're going to look at verse 5 through 11. This is in the New King James Version. New King James Version. Starting at chapter 5, first 5, I'm sorry. Starting at chapter 5. Starting at verse 5. But in accordance with the heart, with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourselves wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each one according to his deeds. Eternal life to those who by patient continuance and doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. But to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. But glory, honor, and peace to everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For there is no partiality with God, meaning that God is not a respecter of person. So we can't because we feel some way about someone, we shouldn't reject them. And how in verse, when they were angry and they were protesting, going back to chapter 20 and verse 11, when they were protesting, they were angry, they got upset. So we can't be angry when God, or we should not be angry when God blesses other people. Let's go to Psalms chapter 37, verse 8. And the New Living Translation. It says, stop being angry. Turn from your rage. Do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. Okay, so, and then James 1 and 19 says, understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. So, again, when we see God blessing somebody, don't automatically just get mad because he ain't blessing you yet. Your blessing is on the way too, right? So just be patient. Your turn is coming. And then being envious and jealous, we'll look at, comparing ourselves. So let's go there right quick. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. And the New King James Version. I need to start doing some of that makeup king and that powder so I won't have that shine in my face. And then it reads, I'm going to read it. For we, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. Nicole's not here today, so everybody know that it's not Nicole. The person that's operating will remain nameless. But it's not Nicole working today, just to let you all know. Verse 12 reads, for we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise, right? So, yeah, I can't compare my situation with your situation, Kenya, and say, okay, I mean, God shouldn't bless you based off what I know about you. That's not, I can't do that. I can't compare outwardly, you know, what God is doing for you. I can't, I shouldn't do that. And then, so that is the grace or the position that we should not hold, right? We should not be grudge hearted. We should not reject what God's word has said. And then I'm going to give you this one, just you can write it down in 1 Thessalonians, because I didn't reference that one. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, it says, "For God did not call us to uncleanness, but in holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who has also given us his Holy Spirit." So when he's called us to be holy and not be, you know, and not be selfish and grudge-hearted towards other people, when we reject that, we're rejecting him. So those are the things that we should not be. Grudge-hearted, we should not reject what God has commanded us to do. We should not be angry, we should not compare ourselves, and we should not be envious and jealous. And I read those, right? Did I read the envious? No, I didn't do that. Okay, let's go to let's go to James chapter 3. Oh, did I just read that? I'm sorry. Wait, let's go to Proverbs. Did we go to Proverbs? Let's go to Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30. And we're going to look at it in the New King James Version. Chapter 14, verse 30. It might help to write it down when I call it out. It says, "A sound heart is life to the body, but envy is rottenness to the bones." Did y'all hear that? We should not be envious, guys. We should not, when God decides that he wants to be generous in somebody else's life, we shouldn't be envious. Mm-mm. We should just let God be God. And then, so what we should be is, we should be generous. We should be giving. We should be righteous, accepting, and accepted in God's love and his adoption, compassionate and edifying. I'm going to give you some scripture for those, and then I'm going to go ahead and close out. But in being generous here, and wow, Pastor, I actually had what he did on his offertory message. I have that somewhere in my notes, but I thought that was, I was like, wow, that's pretty good what he's saying right there. So James, let me see, this is the one I want to read. Yes, so James chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, and the New King James Version. We're going to look at verse, let's look at 4 and 5. Let me see here where this, James chapter 1, verses 4 and 5 in the New King James. Okay. "But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." Okay, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him." So what I want to point out here is, can you go back? So how many, I'm taking y'all to grammar school now, to English. So can you go back to the beginning of that scripture? It says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, comma, I'm sorry, verse 5. Yes. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, comma, who gives to all liberally and without reproach. So that clause there is what I want to pull out there. That clause identifies, right, what God and who he is. Who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. So guess what? He's calling us to be just like him. Is he not? And Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25, in the same version, Proverbs 11, 25, it says, the generous soul shall be made rich, and he who waters will also be water himself. So just like Pastor was saying in his offertory message, God has called, he has blessed us to be a blessing. So as we do that, right, and as we want to see other people blessed, then it all glorifies God. And he calls us to be righteous in Psalms chapter 37, verse 21, in the New King James Version. Psalms 37, 21. It reads, the wicked borrows and does not repay, but the righteous shows mercy and gives. Going back to Christ's landowner's example here in our focal scripture, and being accepted and into the adoption of God, redemption in Christ is Ephesians chapter 1, and we won't go there, verses 3-6, and then being compassionate. That's going to be 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. And I will read this one. It says, finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion one for another. Love as brothers, be tenderhearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reveling for reveling. But on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. So he's calling us to be compassionate one to another. And then the last one, to be edifying and extravagant in forgiveness. I want to look at this is the last one I'm trying to make sure. I'm trying to see which one I want to read here. Let's go here. Let's go to Luke chapter 17 in the New King James Version, verses 3-4. And this is going to be one for being extravagant and being forgiving. Luke chapter 17, verses 3-4, New King James Version. And it says, take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. Amen. So I just want to encourage us this morning just to, as we, you know, let's see if we can have a different outlook when we experience or we witness God blessing other people. And let's make sure that we are in the right position, that our hearts are in the right, on the right side of grace. And that we are not grudge-hearted, but rather we are generous, and that we are blessed and even excited to see God blessing in the lives of those around us. I mean, because really, it's really just a testimony of, you know, hey, he can do the same thing for me. So let us just, again, just grace. What is your position? Amen. Amen. So I hope that today, as you've heard that word, and if you're listening, I hope that God may have spoken some things to you as far as where your heart has been. I know for myself, even in preparing for the message, I was checked myself from a standpoint of, you know, in ministry, it can be, and not giving an excuse, but sometimes we can see things only from our perspective, and it can cause you to really not extend grace sometimes. It can really cause you to only see that you're the only one, you know, that's doing the will of God, if I want to say it that way. Well, that's not always the case, because we don't know. The word tells us that man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. And so however he chooses to do whatever he does, remember that we are all included in that number of having to be to witness grace being granted and to also be recipients of it as well. So I want to extend the opportunity this morning, if you feel like, you know, you're been running in the same circles, it seems like your life is really not going anywhere, and you want to experience His grace, the first thing that you have to do is, and we said it earlier, you have got to go through His Son, Jesus Christ. So we extend that opportunity for you this morning. If you would like to be saved, if you would like to ask Him into your heart, you can do that. The second opportunity that we will give you this morning is we will present an opportunity for you to rededicate. If you know that you have served God, you've been serving Him, and you have a heart to please Him, but there are some challenges and some situations that presented itself in your life and caused you really to harden your heart towards Him and towards other people, then we're giving you the opportunity this morning to say, hey, Lord, I just need you to, I need a transplant. I need you to just to make me over again. And I want to submit my heart to you and ask you to come in and just help me to renew a right spirit, your Holy Spirit, to just to revive it in my life. We give you that opportunity as well. If you would like to partner with us here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, we believe that this is good ground. We believe that the word is being taught, and we believe that God is doing some great things. We'll be glad for you to partner with us as we are on the cusp of a new year. We believe in God to do some great things, and we would be glad if you would partner with us. So if you would like to receive any of those opportunities, you can raise your hands here in the sanctuary, or you can type in the feed. Type in salvation, rededication, or partnership, and we will make sure that we contact you to discuss your quality decision. Amen. We are going to say a prayer, if you would, for those who would like to make a decision. Pray this prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you in Jesus' name. I come acknowledging that I need you in my life. I come submitting my will to yours and acknowledging that He died for me. And I want to say that I need you as my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart. I surrender to you now. I want to live my life for you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 If you have prayed that prayer and you are sincere in praying it and you want God to do a new thing, do as we have just suggested. And hey, if you prayed the prayer, it's already done in Jesus' name. So we come celebrating with you. Amen. For making that quality decision. And let us know you made the decision. And all I want to say is watch God work. Hey, and you can be on the receiving end of working an hour for 10 days and receiving a day's wage. Amen. 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 So we want to thank you all for joining us today. God bless you. I think when we come back, wait, will it be the new year yet? Oh, no, we'll be here Wednesday. We'll be here Wednesday, Bible study. So please join us Wednesday for Bible study. We've been having an awesome time with Bible study. We'll be glad for you to come and join us. And again, thank you for worshiping with us this morning here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, where we are loving God, loving people, and pursuing purpose. All right, God bless you. And hey, I am Pastor Latrilla, and I'm out.